through his flesh. So I said, Shelly, I ain't sick yet.
No.
Why is that? The priest did his job. I'm riding on his coattail. If he did his job. So, many people don't like the way the high priest went in there. Ah, it wasn't sufficient enough. Williams, you got something. My high priest prepared it for me. I was walking behind him, going to the holies of holies, and asked God boldly the things that I desire. Hallelujah. Whatsoever you have the confidence that we have in him. Okay, so, we're going to go back to our lesson. I will say everybody ought to learn Isaiah 53 by next Sunday.
Next
little prayer, a little meditation, we should have it. We'll see. Okay, here we go. Verse 22, it says this. Let us do what? Let us draw near full assurance of faith. So, I said full assurance, and I draw near, 26. The priest's job was to, someone tell me their job in the tabernacle. What was his deal? It was to do what? Go through, he had a ritual. He go through and clean and everything. Showbread table, nice and ready. Over here, the golden candlestick. Nice and ready, cleaned up, do a little ritual over there. All he was doing, until he got through this one wall, or one piece of separation in the tabernacle. The tabernacle was like, come in, out of court, back there is the inner court, they had the separation. No one could go, priest and all this stuff out here, and nobody better not step into here except for who?
The high priest.
And when he stepped into there, he was in the presence of the Lord, called the Holy of Holies. So all the priest was doing is going through these rituals of cleansing, cleaning. It's okay, Mr. High Priest, your turn, you got to go in there. Everything has been cleaned up. Everything's cleaned up out here. That's your lot. Now, the high priest, he had to go into that. Now, so Hebrews, it says here, let us draw near with what kind of a heart? In full assurance of faith that Jesus has cleaned you. That's the question. Do you think Jesus has cleaned you? Because when you go into that Holy of Holies, the only thing that's going to mess up your mind, or mess up your faith wall, people hear is that, am I clean enough to believe in? Because if you ain't clean enough to be in here, if you're not clean enough to be in here, what happens?
They'll
drag you out because you are now dead. That was the way the old way was. The new way is that he has cleansed. You got to be thoroughly convinced that he has cleansed me by what he did for me. His life, death, burial, and resurrection. I'm thoroughly convinced that he did that for me. So I can go into this holy.
I don't look like a holy.
Not worried about, and it says, his flesh. So if you think about your flesh, you're going to come up one short. And then I have to drag you out. So it's not about you. Me, or the church you go to, it's about what he did. Did he in his flesh do it sufficiently enough? Prepare a way for me to get in there. Hallelujah. Okay, that's good. That's a Hebrews 5:26. How do I get clean, man? And how do I grow enough confidently? That's what you want to do, grow confidently enough. Ephesians 5:26. So to go from faith to faith and get bolder and bolder with your request and confidence toward the Lord, how does it happen? how does Jesus continually cleanse me? What did it say, Ephesians 5:26?
That you might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word.
Okay. By the washing of water by his word. His word in you. That's Ephesians 5:26. So, what he does is he sanctifies us, which sets us apart, and gives us sincerity by his word. See, the more words you take in, the cleaner your life's going to get. There's no way you're going to major in sin and be reading and studying this word and stay there. That word's going to eat you up until you get clean. It's going to peel off everything. Wash. Ooh, next thing you know, man, I'm getting cleaner and cleaner. That sin ain't even no fun. It ain't nothing. I'm too clean to be messing with. That's why it says that John says that he that has Christ cannot sin. It's hard for him to. It's impossible for him to enjoy sin because he's got this word. I tell you, whatever's bugging you, you start reading this word, putting some word, getting some word study. That stuff's going to be so uncomfortable to you that you're going to say it's got to go. So he cleanses us by his word. That's the only way you're going to get clean is by the word. Y'all with me?
All right.
Okay. So here we go. Hebrews 10:22 again. Let us draw near with what kind of a heart? True heart. In full assurance of faith. Having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. And then it's brought out again in Hebrews 9:11. We're going to run through the Bible a little bit here. Hebrews 9:11. But Christ being come a high priest. Christ became a high priest of what kind of things? Good things to come. By a greater and more perfect tabernacle. Not made with hands. That is to say, not of this building, he's over a tabernacle that is not earthly. See, the Old Testament, the tabernacle in the wilderness was a prototype, a forerunner of what heaven is set up like. Now, if Christ became a high priest for you and for me. All the cleansing out here, the outer stuff, but the inner stuff in the heart. When I got to get to God, he made it possible that I could just, in a blink of an eye, be in God's presence. If I use my faith and boldly get in front of God, that quick. Or if I do not have my conscience thinking about my sin nature, my sin life, my failure. How do I get rid of all that kind of stuff? The Word of God. Stay in it. Get it in your life. It'll wash all that stuff so far away. You can get in God's presence. Christ made that possible for us. Hallelujah. So, that's what he said in Hebrews 9:11. Christ became a high priest of good things to come. A greater and more perfect tabernacle. It's a tabernacle that's invisible. You won't see it on the earth. It's invisible. And if you've been here Wednesday night, you've heard me say, enter into the invisible and bring it back to the visible. You bring it back to the visible. Because the stuff that's visible is temporary. The stuff that's visible came from the anything you can see with your eye and touch with your hands, smell, all like that, came from the invisible. Woo! You came from the invisible. But you also on the earth. When you die, guess what you return to?
Earth.
Earth. You don't see no hearse wagon dragging the money in the heaven. You take them out here to the yard, leave them 6 feet down, and go to earth. That's where they are. You come back later and check them out, then. Yeah. In the earth, that's where they come from, that's where they go back to. Man. Alright, but wait, that's another lesson altogether. We got time. Okay. So, verse 23. Someone read that if you will, 23 and 24. Before our time gets away from us.
Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful to promise.
Okay.
And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works.
Alright, that's the way that, it's the only way, that's the only way that this verse can become real in your life. Let us hold fast. I mean, in other words, don't bend, don't waver the profession of our faith without wavering. Don't care what comes up in life. Don't bend, stay straight. Yes, staring you in the face. Circumstances contrary to everything that you have heard about the Lord taking care of you. It's out here in the earthly, in the visible. He says, stand straight. Don't bend. Don't waver. Hold fast to what you know in the Lord. Hold fast to what you know. Yeah. Is that what he says? For he is what? Faithful. That promise. See, stuff happens down here on earth. And you got to determine whether you bending, bowing down to it, believing in any other or not. Now, the only way that you can get there, is here, verse 23, hold fast the profession without wavering, faithful to promise. Verse 24 is the only way you're going to do it. Let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works. Now, how does that happen? That's Hebrews, I think, 10:25. This is how you lose out. 10:25, am I right? I jumped ahead. Yeah, 10:25. The only way you lose out and can't stand in faith is because you are not getting resupplied, re-encouraged. The only way that comes is through fellowship. Fellowship. That's what you want me to say. Fellowship. Let us consider one another to provoke. See, I have to provoke Sister Cheryl to talk about it. She come in here sneezing, throwing snot, stuff like that. That's why I got a good flu shot. I'm a girl. How many play sports? Anybody play sports? How'd you get better? The coach is letting you do whatever you want to work out with you. Right. College, you wrestled, didn't you? Yeah. Uh-huh. Okay, just come to practice anytime you want to get a chance. You win. Just eat what you want anytime. Yeah, here's some Oreos. Take it to bed with you. You got to wrestle them at smart, too. What's your chance of winning? What kind of stuff did your coach tell you? Courage, get your butt to bed?
Oh, yeah, exactly.
Get your butt to bed?
Eat right.
Eat right? Nutrition? The whole nine yards can show up tomorrow ready to win.
It's true.
Now, if you just say, take some bag of Oreos and potato chips with you. Make way. And if you don't come to practice, you certainly ain't going to get there. So you have to come to a certain place to get geared up, fired up, whatever, to deal with what's out there. And it ain't going to the open show again. Ricky Lake or whoever. None of that.
pick a leg out.
Okay, Chris Morgan. And all those kind of places. None of that is going to get you what you need. And now here's how people lose out. They go, verse 25. He says, don't forsake the what? It's the manner of some people is. But do what? See, if I don't exhort, Cheryl, I got to exhort. Cheryl, you can do it. You can live without 10 bottles of Tylenol and NyQuil and everybody else. You can make it. You can have faith to make it through the so-called flu season or whatever. You can make it. To tell Brother Travis, you can make it. You can drive by the glass house and don't have to stop in there. They don't need your money. You don't have to support them at the moment. They'll make it without you. But I saw one of my buddies, old school buddies over there. I wanted to swing. No, you don't have to swing in and holler at him. You can make it. But out there in the world, he won't get that type of encouragement. Provoke. Oh, if you make him mad, tell him, boy, he can and can't go. Well, that's all right. I just provoked him. That's what I want to do. I want to make him say, I can do it. I'll show him what he is. Travis, you can live single without 3 or 4 women coming over there every week cooking you dinner. not forsaking the assembly, as a matter of some meals, but exhorting what? One another. So much the more. I mean, really, really get on one another as you see what? The day approaching. Really, really, really encourage one another as you see the day approaching. Pray for one another. Right here, study with one another. And get that slowpoke to church or whatever. You know, get them in the what? Assembly. That's the key. If you don't get in the assembly, you ain't gonna. No way. You never heard that someone says, I'm out here by myself, and I got this big revelation from the Lord of victory and all like that. And I even testified to myself and all this. It's from the church. That testimony inspired me. That song inspired me. That preaching, that scripture inspired me, carried me through the whole week. That's when you get this kind of scripture. This is what he said. And we're talking about getting the Hebrews 11:1. Now, Hebrews 11:1 says what? Faith now. Now faith. You hit the home run every time. Yeah. But we haven't got that far in the letter yet. He's telling you this is how you get there. Verse 26. For if we sin, what? If you hang in sin, after you receive the knowledge of the truth. If you hang in sin after you have received the knowledge of how to be victorious and what he's done for you to be victorious. Now when he says receive means that you have took it into heart. This is what the Lord has done for you. Isaiah 53, his death, burial, life, resurrection. You have taken that to heart. And you have even experienced the grace, the victories that bring to you in life. And then you decide, now I'm going to start going to the red light. I'm going to go get me a smoke. It's warmer than a cool. Warm. When you do it, make me lay back. Well, I get myself in the drink. Well, if you have taken to heart what he has done for you, and then you start sinning, he says what? Somebody asked me, when is the one saved always saved? Who was in here when that hurt? Oh, was that last Sunday? Oh, yeah, that's right, yeah. After you receive the knowledge of the truth, there remain no more sacrifice for sins. There is no other high priest coming along behind you to help you out. But a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation, which shall devour the adversaries. And so, in other words, you have made the Lord very, very mad. You have upset him. You have really made him mad. That's what that is saying. You really made him mad. Remember what he said about Moses when he told Moses, get out of the way, Moses, let me kill them all. Moses standing between the Lord and the people. Get out of the way, Moses, and get ready to kill them. Moses said, whoa. God said, well, they ain't mine, they yours. Moses said, no, they not my people. I said, they ain't mine, get out of the way, I'm going to kill them. What kind of God is God? Is he a jealous God? God is a jealous God. Can you get angry? Yeah, he does get angry. Just like you get angry. Emotions take over. So, he's really mad. Verse 28, he that did not do it the way God told Moses, that's verse 28. How did he get out of here?
He died.
Didn't do it the way God told Moses to tell you to do it. God, Moses told you how to do it, you didn't do it.
Died.
Here I am, full of sin. I'm going to go right on into the mercy seat. Holy of Holies. Aaron's sons.
Bang them out.
And Aaron, don't you even cry over the death of your kids. Because I told them you get cleaned up. So go out there, and Aaron was the priest. Go out there and minister. Don't cry over them. Aaron about to cry. Now, don't you cry. I told him not to come to me like that. So there's saints that don't want to be in church, don't want to be in fellowship, Bible study the whole nine yards, and keep sinning out there. That's what they're trying. Because verse 29 is going to back me up. It's about my lesson. What does it say?
How much sore punishment, suppose ye, shall he be thought worthy, who have trodden under foot the Son of God, and have counted the blood of the covenant, wherewith he was sanctified, an unholy thing, and have done despite unto the Spirit of grace.
How much more do you think God is going to get out of you? You don't hear this on a Sunday morning. You're in the office. How much more? How much more? Suppose ye, should he be thought worthy, who have trodden underfoot the sacrifice of what Jesus made, and had counted the blood of the covenant, where he was cleaned up, an unholy thing, and have done despite unto the Spirit of grace. God says, I'm going to give him. I'm going to wipe them out real quick. I'm going to wipe them out. Just preach a while, be pastor a while, and you be doing eulogies, and you be thanking. Cut off in the middle of his life, young man, young person, things are going so good, what happened? But you gotta say, this stuff goes to family, so you gotta cry. But God is a good God. Yes, he is. I may even sing a song. Yes, he is. But God can be angry, too. Yes, he is. And you don't want him to be what? Angry with you. And verse 30. So we're trying to get to Hebrews 11, but we got to get through this letter. We're trying to have all kind of faith, but we're trying to get through this letter here. What did it say there? Verse 30 in my lesson.
For we know him that has said, vengeance belongeth unto me. I will recompense, saith the Lord. And again, the Lord shall judge his people.
That's in the Bible. That's in the Bible. And that's some preachers that make a living preaching like this. Preaching, keeping you saved by fear. Don't you mess up with God. Anybody ever heard of that? Fire and brimstone preaching? God will do it for you. Yeah. They're not 100% wrong. if it keeps you saved, more power to you. Gotta bring the show in the church, more power to you. I get out here on Sunday mornings for prayer, more power to it. Okay. It is a fearful thing. We're trying to get in faith, but you better realize that God will respond. It is a fearful thing to fall into what kind of hands? The best way to get him mad is that you kick around like an old can in the street what his son has done to him. You know that. You showing him up. You're all in sin, and you know better. You have taken it to heart what the Lord has done for you. And he says, I have no other high priest there to go in and clean them up again. I have no other high priest. You're trying to get the Hebrews to go. Next Sunday.